My name is Thomas, and I enjoy reading stories in my free time. Pretty much any medium. I like comic books. I like novels. I like movies, TV shows. Pretty much any way I'm able to consume a story is what I like to do in my free time. Growing up in the 1990s, I feel it's kind of impossible to not be exposed to comic books. I feel like so much of the pop culture of the 90s was things that were comic adjacent, you know? So before I was reading comics, I was watching TV shows that were about comic book characters. The X-Men animated series, the Batman animated series. So these costumed adventurers were always kind of a part of my larger framework of pop culture. So it was very easy to move from these cartoons onto actual comic books. I think the thing that appeals to me most about comic books is the larger exploration of humanity, whether it be these fantastic feats that we're capable of or the flaws that we have to overcome. Comics are such a huge medium where you can find action, adventure, horror, romance, whatever you like, whatever kind of stories you like in other media you consume, whether that be novels or television or cinema, there's absolutely a comic book for you. Yeah, I think comics are for everybody. That's not fair. That's not fair to ask, you know? It depends on my mood greatly. I guess gun to my head, I would say my favorite character is Peter Parker, the Amazing Spider-Man. Spider-Man was definitely my favorite when I was a kid, and I think that's still true today. I've always connected with the kind of everyman concept of Peter Parker, the Amazing Spider-Man. But with Peter Parker, even though he does have these fantastic powers, I like that so much of his comic book narrative isn't just him doing all of these fantastic, amazing things. It's him living his real life, him still trying to make sure the rent is due, trying to make sure that Aunt May is taken care of. You know, all of these things that normal folks have to deal with, he has to do all of that stuff still and still have that added power and responsibility factor of making sure that his neighborhood is safe. My advice for someone getting into comic books would be to go to a local comic book store. Go and check it out. These are such visually striking books that you can go in and you'll find something that appeals to you. And most comic book shops are run by people that live and breathe for this stuff. They want to make you a comic book fan, and they'll do what they can to turn you on to something that's really cool. You know, you have these multi-million-dollar blockbusters that are based on these comic book characters. So it's a larger fandom than ever, and I guarantee that the folks working at these comic shops would be happy to welcome you into it and find something that you love.
Arias. My hobby is racing, and my friend here has a few questions to ask me about it.
What do you find appealing about cars?
For me personally, what I find appealing is just the personal levels behind vehicles, and like the ability to make it something different compared to others.
What do you think of the aesthetics / looks of cars?
I think it's important. Like the first question, like why do I like cars? It's important because you can tell really the personality of the person just from their car. And the fact that they give like the car itself personality. You can make it look how you like. You can really tell how the person thinks, acts from a car. Because, you know, if they don't have it maintained, it's dirty. It's like, you know, they're really using it just to get around. They don't really care. But, you know, if it's nice, you know, if they upgrade it, if they stylize it, you can tell they're pretty creative and, you know, they're responsible and such.
Do you think it's too easy to get a license?
I believe as of recently it is, because from personal experiences, when I got my license, I thought it was going to be pretty much hell. Like, as we're seeing more and more now, you know, we have younger drivers on the streets now, and a lot of them are inexperienced, and it causes a lot of mayhem. And even the older generation, too. You know, you get old, and then, you know, you stop having the skills you once had. So I feel like it is a little bit easier, and the curriculum needs to be a little bit harder for licenses.
How long have you been into cars and racing in general?
When it comes to cars and racing, I don't really have a definite answer to that, because for racing, it's not something you just follow. Well, yeah, for some people it is, but for me, racing wasn't something I just fell in love with. It just happened. Like, I don't know what point of time it did. It's just, I know one second I just liked racing. My latest memory was 2015, but I have vivid memories of even beforehand, like 2012, 2013. But it's kind of hard to pinpoint when exactly I like cars, because, you know, you just love it over time.
What about collecting toy cars? When did that start?
So toy cars, as we've seen here, as a fellow racing fan, it's natural to want to collect things, and cars was one of my choices. So for these, my earliest memory is 2012, you know, going to a Toys R Us and just seeing these. And then I just fell in love with them. So these are my oldest, 2012. I remember getting this back in elementary school when I was like in 5th, 6th grade. I got this one on my 13th birthday on a cake. And I remember my mom going to making the cake, so this one's pretty special. I think when collecting, it's important to have something to bring you to the sport, because racing and all that's expensive. So by collecting, it kind of cheapens the load a bit.
Hello everyone, this is my tutorial on how to make garlic parmesan fries. To begin, this recipe uses specifically russet potatoes because they tend to fry the best and have the classic fry taste. The first step you're going to want to do is clean your russet potatoes thoroughly. Potatoes are grown under the soil and we don't want to cook the debris with our food. After you're done washing your potatoes, go ahead and cut them into fry slices. The shape of the slices doesn't necessarily matter if they're thick or thin, just as long as they're cut consistently. We need them to be cut consistently so that they can cook evenly and finish together. As you can see, I left the skin on my potato, but if you're so inclined, you can remove the skin and get rid of it. Alternatively, you can even fry the skin separately for a tasty snack. When you're done cutting up all your slices, put them all into a strainer for the next step. Now you're going to rinse the slices. We need to rinse the starch out to remove the odd taste, and it allows the slices to get even crispier while cooking. After the water starts to run clear, set the slices aside to air dry. After you've set your slices aside to dry, grab 3 to 4 pieces of fresh garlic and peel off their skins. Now, you're going to dice the garlic into small pieces. The smaller the better, since this will allow them more surface area to spread their flavor. Alternatively, you can skip the cutting and use pre-diced, jarred garlic, but I personally like the taste of fresh garlic. After you've processed your garlic, transfer them into a heat-resistant bowl for the next step. Now that we've got our potato slices and diced garlic ready, you're now going to turn on your stove. Put it at a medium heat, grab your frying pan, add your favorite oil, and wait for the pan to heat up. To check the heat of the oil, take a single fry and dip it. If there are no bubbles, you need to wait. If there are bubbles, you are ready to cook. As you start adding your slices, use the rim of the pan to slide them in instead of dropping them from your hand. This reduces the amount of splashback and minimizes your burn risk. With all your slices set, be sure to check and rotate them regularly so that all sides have time with the heat. If you're curious, I'm using safflower oil, but any high heat tolerable oil is also fine for this recipe. Since all pans and kitchens are different, cook time can vary, so check regularly and don't forget to rotate. After some time in the pan, your fries will start to become golden to golden brown in color. When they are colored on all sides, they are fully cooked. At that stage, you can remove them or let them sit a few minutes more so that they can get even crispier. When you're satisfied, remove the fries quickly and place them into the heat-resistant garlic bowl from earlier. With the fries still hot, begin to mix everything together. The residual heat and oil will gently cook the garlic, allowing it to release its flavor. While mixing, add your Parmesan and salt so that it can stick to the hot fries. With everything combined, add some additional Parmesan to your liking and enjoy. The fun part about making fries is just how much you can customize them. Feel free to experiment by using other seasonings like lemon pepper or adding your own preferred spices. You can also pair the fries with dressings and your favorite garnishes. This dish works well alone, but also works with other main dishes. This recipe is super simple, and I hope you enjoy the fries you've made.
Hello, my name is Jonathan Rodriguez, and today I'll be showing you how to use a Mamiya C330 Twin Lens Reflex Camera, or TLR for short. The term twin lens reflex camera comes from the two lenses that you see here on the front. The top one here is called the viewfinder, and it is used so that you may set up your shot correctly, and this bottom one here is called the taking lens, which exposes your film to the light. These particular types of cameras are known as medium format film cameras, and they take a special kind of film called 120 film, like this Porsche 400. You load film onto the camera by turning the little dial on the back of the camera so that the red dot faces towards the top of the camera. Then push it towards the direction the arrow is facing and pop open the back. Inside the camera, you'll see two slots. One is empty and where you'll be putting your film in, and the other already has an empty film spool in it where you'll be feeding your film through. To load film into the camera, you simply pull and twist these knobs on the side of the camera and slide your film in. Make sure to push these knobs back when your film is in to make sure it's secured properly. Next, you want to take the tab from the roll of film and pull it towards the empty film spool. The film spool will have a little slot for you to slide in this tab. When it's in, you'll want to use the crank lever and advance the film until the arrows reach the stop line. After that, you can close the back of the camera and twist the dial back. Now you're ready to go out and make some photos. This camera doesn't have an exposure meter like most modern digital cameras do, so you're going to have to find out your correct exposure settings through some other way. I like to use the Lux app on the iPhone to find out my correct settings. Simply set your ISO to the number that was on your film wrapper and point your phone camera at whatever you want to photograph, and the app should tell you your correct settings. The camera is held at waist level and you look through your viewfinder to set up your shot. You will notice that whatever direction you move, the scene in the viewfinder will move with the opposite direction. Set up your shot and use the focus knobs to adjust to the proper focus, and press the shutter release button at the bottom of the camera to capture your photo. To unload your film, you're going to want to turn the film advance lever a few times to make sure the film inside is warmed well enough that it won't get accidentally exposed to light when you remove it from the camera. Just like when you put film inside of the camera, you're going to want to turn this dial so that the red dot faces towards the top of the camera, and then push it open to pop open the back. Pull the side dials out, and your film is released. Simply pull back on the dial and remove the new film spool and put it in the top slot. And you're now ready to add a new roll of film.
Certain things you just can't refuse. She wanna ride like a cruise, and I'm not trying to lose. Then you're left in the dust, unless I stuck by ya. You're a sunflower, I think your love would be too much. Or you'd be left in the dust, unless I stuck by ya.
Yes, I would become him. I would save everyone. This, I believed. Yet still they cried out in rage and despair. Divided over the fate of the star, a rare occurrence, always fleeting, but not this time. Not this time. Reconciliation. Elidibus. I was needed. I withdrew myself from Zodiac. For them. My people. My brothers. My friends. Stay strong. Keep the faith. At duty's end, we will meet again. We will. We will. The rains have ceased, and we have been graced with another beautiful day. But you are not here to see it. Yeah.